We're going to praise God. We're going to sing to Him. We're going to worship Him. And as we do, we're going to, of course, have all the lyrics up here for you to read and follow along. But I want to start in prayer because we believe here that the Word of God is true. Whatever it says is true. And He says if two or more of us gather in His name, He's in the midst of us, which means He's present. And just saying that, I feel the presence of God around us. That's what He's looking for. He's looking for people to place a demand on Him and say, I believe in You. I believe in Your presence. And I want You with me. And He comes. So Lord, we welcome You here tonight. We welcome You in this place tonight. We ask God that You would show up and show off. That You would move on our behalf because our hearts are hungry. We long for the fullness of You. We don't want just a part. We don't want a portion. We want all of You that we can receive. So we welcome You here tonight. Let Your power, let Your anointing manifest, Lord. Work through the worship, work through the word. Anoint our guest speaker tonight to speak under the unction of the Holy Spirit. I know He will because He's your friend and He loves you. So I know He's subject to You, and I'm looking forward to a fresh word from heaven for us here at Antioch. Lord, we bless You tonight. We bless You, and we make an agreement with You tonight that we're not going to stop You. We're not going to limit what You can do in us. We open up. That's why we're here. So we bring down any barriers, any resistance we may have. We bring it down and we say, Lord, have Your way in us. If you can say that with me, say, Lord, have Your way in me. Just say it like that. Lord, have Your way in me. Tonight, Lord, this is Your place. This is Your environment. We want to worship You. We want to exalt You in this place. Lord, be high and lifted up here with us tonight. Jesus, we pray. If you agree, say amen. Give a hand clap of praise to the Lord. Stand to your feet. Come on, we're going to praise Him. Thank you. Let's pray for His liberty. River of life, come and wash over me. River of life, fill me with
Thank you. Kingdoms above all. Thank you.
just to spend another moment with you. There is no one quite like you.
Say it again.
There's no one quite like you. There is nothing. Changed from inside out. The air around you is charged with life. Every moment with your pride. I'm baptized in holy fire. And it makes me want to shine. There's no one quite like
to just make God feel very comfortable here with us so he can
can do whatever he wants. He does too. He wants attention. He takes over. We couldn't even end the service Thursday night. It just wouldn't. I tried. I couldn't. He was like, no, you're not going to do that. You're going to keep worshiping me. And I think that we as a church, we need to be subject to the Spirit of the living God's hands. Oh, it's good to be in the house of God. I was glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house. Better is one day in his courts. Better is one day in his house than 1,000 anywhere else. You can go spend 1,000 days wherever you want, and I will gladly trade that for one day, just one moment in the presence of God. Oh, I love Jesus. I love Jesus. You're welcome here today. Lord, we also want you to make a difference in us tonight. We want to walk out of this place very different than how we've entered. We all come here carrying weights. We all come here with problems, situations in our lives, but we know that you are the problem solver. You're the miracle worker. You're the way maker. And we trust you, Lord, that you're going to make a way through every obstacle, through every problem we may face in life, no matter what's going on. You are the one. And as we worship you and come into your presence, we know that you very powerfully and realistically are here to bring healing, to bring deliverance, to bring change to our life. And that's what we want, Lord. Help us to do the things that are not possible for us to do. We can do the natural, but only you can do the supernatural. You are bigger than governments. Yes. You're bigger than visas. You're bigger than payments. You're bigger than credit cards. You're bigger than anything. You're bigger than doctors and their diagnoses. You're bigger than all things. And we give you the place of preeminence. You're high and lifted up as the king of all things. You're the king of every king. You have no beginning. You have no end. You are the eternal God. Oh God, we honor you. We love you. Thank you for your grace and mercy here with us tonight. Do whatever you want to do in our midst. We come into agreement about that tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, we have a special treat tonight. We have Pastor Boon Chow. We'll talk a little bit about the first time I met him. It was through a mutual friend of ours who was Pastor Edward Pusson. And I was just sharing testimony earlier that the first time I met Ed was with his wife, Lai King, when I first received Jesus 30 years ago, or 29 years ago in a bit, when I got saved and I had not met Christians. I got saved on my own through a series of supernatural events and a guy on a TV. And so that's the day that I turned the TV on, and the very second I turned the channel, the man said, "Do you want to receive Jesus Christ as your first person?" That's the short story. The whole story is quite wild and how it happened. But after that, I needed to find Christians, and I ended up in the company of a relative of mine who was a church member. And they took me to their house, and they said, "We have a meeting tonight, a prayer meeting." And it was the first meeting that I was ever in, first corporate prayer environment, and it was Ed and Lai King Pusson, who are missionaries here in Singapore, who led the prayer for the nations. So it was part of God's preparation for me to prepare to send me to the world. And so when I came here to Singapore after being in Mexico and India for all those years, I remembered that Ed had come here. And I had not talked to him in more than 20 years. But I found him, I tracked him down, and he's not an easy man to find because, you know, he doesn't believe in a lot of the technology that a lot of us believe in. But I found him, and he said, "Yes, I would love to meet you." And I went when he was teaching Bible school at Trinity. I went over there, and he had me come in the class. And he remembered me from 20 years before. And so I remember that meeting, and he said, "I want you to share your story with my Bible school students." And I did. I shared my testimony. The power of God fell in the Bible school. And he, led by the Spirit, he said, "We need to do something." Remember, it's very significant. In his classroom at that time, he had 8 nations, pastors from 8 different countries all over Southeast Asia. And he said, "I want all of you to come up and stand around, Brother Stephen." And they came up and stood around. This first time I had not really been in any relationship with any churches or anything. I'd just seen the vision from the hotel in Clarkie, and God told me, come here, and he was going to use me. They stood around me, and Brother Ed led a prayer and said, we, the pastors of Southeast Asia, we extend a welcome and the right hand of fellowship to you to come into Asia and do what God has called you to do. And there was like a breaking, I felt it in the spirit, that released. And right from that moment, the door was wide open for me to tie and connect to churches. And one of the first connections I had really after that was one was with Kum Yan. And God opened that door for me to start going. The first time I went, the second time, the third time, the fourth time, the fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth time. I don't know how many times I've been in, but it's you know, it's part of my life now. And I really believe, and I'm looking forward to what he's going to share tonight about what the Lord's telling him, because I think it's very significant to us. So I want you to open up your hearts, open up your minds. We as Antioch are a servant ministry to all the churches of Singapore, including their church. So we want to hear what we can do. And I'm interested in hearing it. He's a great guy, and I love having him here. Once we give a warm welcome to Pastor Benjamin.
Thank you, Pastor Stephen, for such a generous introduction for Kum Yan. And I'm thrilled to be here. You know, when Pastor Stephen tells you, can you come and speak? You tremble from the inside. And you tell yourself, you better go to God and hear from God. You know? You better get on your knees and you better be praying night after night after night. See, because if it isn't from God, he'll know. So, I just want to share with you, I'm not one that is known for his eloquence, but I believe in my time with the Lord, in the past few weeks after he told me to come share, God has laid on my heart some things which I was very, very excited about. And maybe just before we begin, we just go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? So Father, we thank you for the way you speak to us, the way you connect us, that you are God who is just so wonderful, and you work wonders in our lives. Father, we thank you that you've connected Antioch, Center of the Nations, and Kum Yan Church, and I thank you for Pastor Stephen. I thank you. I've been here for worship numerous times, and I enjoy myself, and I know the presence of God is here. And I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to share and to speak. And so, Lord, may you hide me behind the cross and just release what you want to release. It's not about me, but it's about you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I had asked the Lord what I should say, and I waited before the Lord for a few nights. And on Tuesday night, I remember, for 2 hours I was before the Lord. And I was praying, and I was praying, and I was in His presence. And about an hour and a half of my time, into my time with Him, He began to speak to me. And the first thing He impressed on me was, 1 Queen Street, 1 Pemimpin. 1 Queen Street, 1 Pemimpin, 1 Queen Street. And you know, when God touches you with something that has never appeared in your mind, you tremble from the inside. And I began to tremble from the inside because God was speaking. It was like He was opening up a window in heaven for me to get a glimpse of what He is doing. It's like a glimpse into His workshop, what He's telling and what He's showing, that this is what I'm doing. Right? So as I was waiting before the Lord, and I was just trembling from the inside, and He gave me another word. He said, Elizabeth and Mary. Elizabeth and Mary. And I began to connect. Oh, I remember the story. What happened when Elizabeth met Mary, when Mary went to Elizabeth. And that was the second thing that impressed upon me. And I was really on the floor, and I was saying, God, you know, it has never occurred to me that 1 Queen Street, 1 Pemimpin, was connected to Elizabeth and Mary. This was God showing me a window in heaven. And then the thing He showed me was 3 words for Antioch Center. I want you to share three words. And they are not significant as in that it is mind-blowing, but just three simple words that he shared with me. I'm going to share with you what are those three things later. But I would like to share with you from the scripture first, the three things that he showed to me about one priesthood and one community. And he told me that it is divine ordination for him to have worked in one Queen Street and one pemimpin. The first thing, divine ordination. And the second thing is divine connection. Second thing, divine connection. And the third thing is divine partnership. So he says, mark these three things between one Queen Street, Kum Yan, and one pemimpin, Antioch, Center for the Nations. So I'm going to just share with you what he laid on my heart. And the first thing he said to me was divine ordination. The birth of John the Baptist, as I began to read this, and the birth of Jesus were both divine ordinations. And as I read verses 11 onwards, then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you have to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord of their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah said, asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news." And when his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. This is the birth of John the Baptist foretold. Then there was the birth of Jesus foretold. In the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel, same angel, to Nazareth, a town of Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her 6th month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel of the Lord left her. Both Elizabeth and Mary, both the birth of Jesus and both the birth of John the Baptist, were separately communicated to Zechariah and separately communicated to Mary. And the parents of John the Baptist, by the appearance of the angel Gabriel, and to Mary and Joseph, of course, earthly parents of Jesus, again by the appearance of the angel Gabriel. The connection is there. There's a certain connection by Gabriel, and Gabriel told Mary about Elizabeth. God connected them. And there was a clear purpose. God had communicated the clear purpose to Zechariah, what God wanted to do. And God communicated to Mary about Jesus, what God wanted Jesus to be and to do. So there is clear purpose of God communicated, and He was speaking to me that there's clear purpose given to Antioch Missions Center for the Nations. And 1 Queen Street, there's clear purpose that's given to us. And these are both divine ordinations, but 1 Queen Street, 1 Pemimpin. And God was impressing on me that He has specially ordained these two ministries. And because they have been ordained, God has caused them to see His miracles. God has caused them to experience His glory. And God has also miraculously provided for each of these two ministries. And He has also shown us the purpose that He has given to 1 Queen Street and 1 You know, as I was talking to Pastor Stephen in the months and in the weeks past, he was telling me how you had come to 1 Pemimpin. And I don't have to tell the story. He probably would have told you last week when he preached and when he shared the vision about 1 Pemimpin. And I've heard stories about how you've been walking around and praying and talking to people, where can we go? Where can we go, Lord? And then you came here by chance and you looked at the lobby and said, yes, this is the place. This is it. You know, the Lord has given and the Lord is providing. And how I'm hearing that the Lord is providing your rental, providing all these, and by faith. Right? So in the same way, because 1 Pemimpin has been given and called into what God wants you to do, the same way I'm seeing 1 Queen Street. Right? In the same way. And I'm going to share with you, you've heard 1 Pemimpin, I'm sure, but I'm going to share with you what has been happening in 1 Queen Street. There is that affinity. When I hear from Pastor Stephen what's happening here, I seem to get the same feeling that God is communicating this to us as well. And we are an old church. We are 96 years old this year. But what has been happening in the past few years has been significant. You know, in the year 2005, there was a pastor named Pastor George Anadore. It was a week where I had no speaker, so I was just asking around, is there a speaker? And I was told, there are two or three speakers that you can ask. So I asked the first one, you could make it. And the second one was George Anadore. So I called him and said, can you come? And he said, okay, I'll come. And when he came to preach, when he came to speak at our church, that service took double the amount of time. Because what he released really blew us away. And he was running International House of Prayer at that time, right in the middle of the city. And he shared and he came, you know, the Lord has told us to pray for Kum Yan Methodist Church. And we never knew him. We didn't know where he was, what he represented. And said that we've been praying for you for months. And the Lord has told us to pray for 7 churches in the civic center of Singapore and not to pray for other churches. He said, but we are a house of prayer for Singapore. We need to pray for many churches. The Lord says, no, you pray for these 7. And one of them is Kum Yan Church. Don't go to Kum Yan Church and tell them you're praying for them until they invite you. So when he said that, and I never had any intention of inviting me, just one empty spot. And then he came. He said, don't tell them until they invite you. And I invited him and he came and he released this. And he said that he saw, as they were praying for Kum Yan Church, a vision of men and women in the garb of the 1920s, 1930s, praying for the church. And he said that these are your forefathers praying for you, praying for the future generation. And this is what God told him, and he released these words. You have been marked by heaven. For what reason, I don't know, but it could be very well because your founders, when they first founded this church 87 years ago, they had unleashed a cry. They had lifted up a cry before the Lord on behalf of this land and a certain people around this land. And something is happening now. Something is happening now. And so we received this word, and he told us about the picture that The founding fathers had been praying for the future generation, and God is going to fulfill this call that He has given the founding fathers. And we responded. We said, Lord, so at the end of it, He facilitated whatever things that have been prayed for, right, by our forefathers, we received them. And Father, we are sensing that You're calling us to stand in agreement with those prayers. And as we stand in agreement, we ask of You to fulfill that which You have intended for us. So as a church, we stood up for this church, for our children, and for our children's children. Allow all of heaven to be unleashed here on earth because of what You have called us, One Queen Street. And as I remember this, I remember now there's one pemimpin as well. That was in 2005. Then in 2006, we invited him to come for our family camp. And he came as the speaker. So on the last day, he finished all his talks. And he said, he was closing up and he said that, you know, I believe that the Lord wants you to intensify your worship and prayer. And whilst he was concluding his final talk, you know, just something like this, and he was speaking to maybe 500-600 of us who were at that camp, and says, I sense God wants me to stop here and facilitate a response from you. Because the Lord says He wants you to intensify your prayer and your worship. And He says that you should have morning prayer, evening prayer, morning prayer, evening prayer. And he made a joke of himself, said, being Indian, he said, oh, I got to continue. And he continued, but as he was continuing, and it was in the huge auditorium in a hotel, suddenly he hit the music stand, which is something like this, and the whole stand fell to the ground, and all his the Bible and all his stuff that was in it fell. And as the music stand hit the ground, lightning struck, thunder roared. And the lights of the whole hotel went zzz, 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 and went up. And everybody sat there. And for the next 5 seconds, you know when the glory of God comes, everybody sees it. Right? The presence of God, different people would sense the presence of God. But when the glory of God comes, everybody feels it. Everybody sensed it. And then it was him who spoke. He was the next person to say, I think I better stop and facilitate a response for you to say, God, yes, we will be ready if You want us to intensify our prayer and our worship. And so that was miraculously orchestrated by God. So we were thinking, okay, how are we going to begin prayer, worship? You know, One Queen Street, what is this all about? Nothing much happened. We tried a little bit and we started some prayer meetings here and there. And we grew in some ways as a local church, praying for ourselves and praying for the work in our church and praying for the nation. But it was not until, but along the way, God confirmed. And the next family camp, we had a speaker who came and he released the word, go into corporate prayer. And then the next family camp, he says, God has assembled anointed people in this church with worship gifts in your midst. Your worship brings the presence of God. So different speakers had then subsequently come and tell us that this is what He wants, worship and prayer. And so we were thinking, God, You keep telling us, You keep telling us, but what should be happening? And we don't know how to respond, what to do. It was not until March 2012 that God unleashed something that took us by surprise, and we stood in awe, but it didn't take us by surprise in a way. When Love Singapore, I think many of you know Love Singapore, they're a movement in Singapore, and they have been at the forefront of leading many churches in Singapore's spiritual growth, headed by a few of the mega churches. And they called up and said, Kum Yan Church, will you be the prayer tower of the nation? My hair stood up when I received that call from the representative. Said, can you do morning prayer, 6:30 to 8:30 every day? And we stood back and we said, wow, this is what You're preparing us for. Love Singapore knows that we are called as a nation, not only for ourselves, but for Antioch, as an Antioch for the nations. And so when we are the prayer tower for the nations, many, many churches will come and pray 6:30 to 8:30 every morning. And up to now, it's been happening for 1.5 years. One Queen Street. You know, there are many prayer meetings that happen across this city. But then when there is one place where all the churches gather, or different churches, people from different churches gather, that's the place that will represent the city. And at the same time, I'm thinking about One Queen Street, one room. God is tying the two together. So we are excited, and this morning I woke up at 5:30, and then we had morning prayer, 6:30, 8:30. So different churches will come, and we anchor all the Sundays. Kum Yan Church anchor all the Sundays. And we have been very, very excited, and we know it's such a privilege, because when we pray, we do not only pray for our church, we pray for all the churches in Singapore, we pray for our nation, we pray for the nations, we pray for what God is going to do between now and the time He returns, we pray for Back to Jerusalem movement, we pray for missionaries out in the field, we pray for all the nations, we pray for Singapore as a catalyst to China, to India, to all the nations around. And when I hear Pastor Stephen says, we're sending missionaries to all the nations around, I begin to see the connection between One Queen Street and One Queen. So if that is the magnitude of things that God is looking at, God is birthing something fantastic, something that eyes have not seen and ears have not heard in this place. A little bit more about our story. So I went back and I was thinking, wow, One Queen Street, something special. So I went back to our history books and I started reading. And I began to realize that the church had no place to meet when they first started in the early 1900s. They had no place to meet, just like you guys. No place to meet. So they were borrowing this place, borrowing that place, you know. And then, and then moving around. So, and that was before the Second World War. So there was, during the Second World War, they said, okay, let's start to raise funds. So they started to raise funds. And something significant happened during the Second World War, which encouraged me. But maybe back to this story later. So during the Second World War, they raised funds, but after the war, you know, during the Second World War, the people here spent banana money. You know what's banana money? It's Japanese money, not British money, not Singapore money, but banana money. So after the war, all the money that they had amassed for the building fund became zero. So they called banana money, so worthless. So $10,000 they raised became worthless. But they were men of faith. So they said, okay, we're not going to give up. So on the 1st of January 1946, they gathered for a prayer meeting to give thanks to God, because that's just after the war. So they give thanks to God and they say, God, thank you so much. And at that prayer meeting, long, long time ago, before any one of us were born, even the leaders in the church were born, the Holy Spirit spoke to the pastor. Pastor's name was Reverend Carl, and says that restart the building fund, look for a piece of land, and call the church Kum Yan Church. These were the two words they received during the prayer meeting. So they looked for a place. They looked for a place. For 3.5 years, they looked for a place. They couldn't find a place. Until one day, somebody called up. They were a bit dejected. Somebody called and says, hey, there's this place down at 1 Queen Street. Will you come and take a look? So the leaders all went down. And when they stepped onto the land, amen, Holy Spirit spoke to them and said, this is the place. So they agreed, this is the place to be, number 1 Queen Street. And this is the place that God, and they wrote in the church records, the Lord Himself had determined the location of the church. This exact translation from Chinese into English, right? And in unison, we declare that God Himself has chosen this good place. And so they chose the place. And today, we're the prayer tower for the nations. You see, God has birthed something special in 1 Queen Street, and God has also birthed something special in 1 Queen Street. And He's tying the two together. He gave me Elizabeth Mary, and He's tying the two together. So, it just blows me away. And you know, this Reverend Carl, side story I just want to share with you. And they were men of faith. And this guy, Reverend Carl, he was just one of the church leaders at that time. And when the Japanese came, he was a community leader. So they incarcerated him, they arrested him. You know, the Japanese are very good at arresting people, and you know. And they arrested him. They said, "Will you help us? We need your help. We want your help. You're a community leader." He said, "No, you're Japanese. I don't want to help you." And he was brave. I thought, and I think he thought probably that he's not going to get out, right? But after 3 days, they released him. They released him after 3 days. And immediately he said, "I'm going to be the pastor of the church." And he became the pastor of the church. My mind was thinking, gosh. You know, if I'm him, I'll probably say, "Well, I better lie low for a while, right? So they may rearrest me. I become the pastor of the church, they may rearrest me and they take me in, and this time it's a one-way ticket. You know, I won't get out." But he became the pastor of the church. And because of his faithfulness, at that prayer meeting on 1st of January 1946, God gave him the word, restart, and call the church Kum Yan Church. We were not called Kum Yan Church. Kum Yan means Thanksgiving in Cantonese. So as I'm thinking, you had no name, but you're called Antioch, Center for the Nations. God is giving you a name. And He's going to fulfill the promises that He's given to you to be a mission center for the nations. Both of us are connected. Kum Yan, 1 Queen Street, 1 Pemimpin, and to eternity. The second thing, divine connection. The two births were divinely connected with one another. Verse 39. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill His promises to her." Angel Gabriel told Mary that Elizabeth, your relative, is also 6 months with child. So the angel Gabriel had connected. And so immediately Mary, after hearing, after replying, verse 39, she got ready and hurried to the town to look for Elizabeth. You see, God has connected both of them. So Mary hurried there. And when she appeared at a relative's home, what happened? The baby, upon hearing Mary's voice, leaped for joy. Because there is a divine connection. And there's a divine connection between 1 Queen Street and 1 Pemimpin. God was impressing that on me as He released these words to me. And Mary's greeting brought two divine affirmations, right? Elizabeth's baby leaped in the womb and she received the Holy Spirit. The two things that happened. And even the baby leaped for joy in the mother's womb. Divine connection between our two churches. Pastor Stephen was sharing with you how he first came to Kum Yan. And to me, it's like God bringing Mary to Elizabeth. You know? And we are so privileged. Like this is, you know, Mary is the mother of the Lord. And we will ask, "Oh, why so privileged?" You know? And He has been blessing us tremendously. And even His coming to us has been affirmed. There were three affirmations that we are divinely connected. You know, the first time He came to speak, and after that, being a very good host, I took him across to Dome, which is an expensive place to have breakfast and have coffee. And we sat down and we talked. You know, it's just like, you know, some connection that's happening. And halfway through the meal, he said, "You know, there's something I want to tell you. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but the Holy Spirit's been prompting me to tell you this." And he said, "You know, I'm looking for a place, and this place that I'm staying, the landlord wants it back in a couple of months, and I have nowhere to go. So I don't know why I'm telling you this, because the Holy Spirit's been prompting me 2 or 3 times to tell you this." You know, it's strange. The first time you meet someone, you go to church to speak, and you tell him, "No, I can move out of my house." You know, it's totally out of your mind. So I was thinking, gosh, strange guy. What have I gotten myself into, you know? So, but I said, okay, let me pray about it, let me think about it, and maybe there's some people I can talk to. So I went back and I talked to this church leader, and the church leader said, "Yeah, okay, let me think about it, maybe we can, this place that I have, maybe it's suitable." So, then he had invited me to come, you know, visit him at the shelter. So that one of those evenings I went down, and it was at the shelter that my phone rang, and it was this church leader. And then, yeah, and
I... In the shelter.
Yeah. So I spoke to the leader and said, "Maybe we can arrange for a meeting," and he go down and see the flat, the apartment. And when he... And it was arranged, I think that was a... Just 2 or 3 days later, we made that arrangement, and then he went down. And when he stepped in, he says, "Yes, this is the place." And he can tell you, he says, because casually between him and Barbara, they've been talking. You know, I've been living in Singapore. Yeah, that's a great place that we have. But wow, if it were just wooden flooring in the house, you know, when you're in the US or in North America, it's wooden flooring, right? And it's so comfortable, right? And so when he stepped into the house, because this church leader imports exotic wood, so his masonette HDB is all wooden paneling. There's no second house in Singapore with just wooden panel. And he was so moved, because just a simple thought that maybe, you know, it would be so nice if we had wooden panel floors. And God would answer that. And that's and the unit is exactly the same design as the one that he's living in now.
Yeah.
And now he's there. And that's divine connection between 1 Queen Street and 1 Pemimpin. And then, as if that's not enough, then the next time that he came, after he preached, there was one sister in the church who came up to him. "Do you have somebody that you're related to in Tokyo? Because when I go there, I connect with somebody by the name of Nicole, and we work together in the church in Tokyo, from Kum Yan Church." And that's the second affirmation. Right? We have only one person who goes to Tokyo, or who goes to Japan, you know, regularly. And it has to be that church that she is connected with, and it has to be that person that she's connected with. Second. And the third time he came was like this. There was a guy from Cambodia, right, whom Pastor Stephen had invited to come and join the training here. So he came on a Saturday, right, and somebody had invited him to a church. So Pastor Stephen said, okay, let's get all the stuff done up, and then I'll take a look at the address later, and then I'll tell you how to go to whichever church that you've gotten invited to. So when he took a look, right, after everything was done, at the end of the day, it was number 1 Queen Street Covenant Church that this person wants to go to. And on that Sunday, the next day, he was speaking at Covenant Church. So he said, "Oh, you can come with me." Is that chance? Is that coincidence?
No.
It is the divine connection between Kum Yan to and number 1 Pemimpin, which is Antioch. God is connecting us. A third, divine partnership. Not only was there a divine connection, there was a divine partnership. what happened after the conversation between Elizabeth and Mary? Mary burst into song. Mary burst into song and she sang, "My soul glorifies the Lord and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior," and so on and so forth. And she sang. And right at the end in verse 56, Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. There was divine partnership between Elizabeth and Mary. I know one thing for sure, they worshiped together. Mary burst into song. And I'm sure Elizabeth was worshipping just as Mary burst into song. And who would stay with your relatives for 3 months? What were they doing? 3 months together, just wondering, no? Two women together, what were they doing? I'm sure there are times of prayer, times of worship, times of affirming one another, times of sharing. Wow, you know, when Gabriel appeared to me, this was what he said, and this was how he looked like. Yeah, you know, Gabriel, good-looking guy. So I'm sure there was a divine partnership between them, affirming one another. Because this is not an appearance from God or the glory of God or the run-of-the-mill kind of thing. It is something significant. And it required great faith for them to respond. It required great faith for them to say, "Yes, I will be the one to carry this child that you have given to me. And I will be the one who will carry John the Baptist. I will be the one who carry Jesus." There was collaboration and there was support. So Mary stayed another 3 months. So 6 months plus 3 months, right? Simple mathematics, right? Not rocket science, 9 months. So Mary left just before the baby was born. So there is a divine partnership that God has given to us. I have been absolutely thrilled by being associated with Steve and Nicole. And just a few weeks ago, in the past 2 or 3 months, I've been crying out before the Lord for my church and for me and saying, "God, no more of the same. We want more. We want your glory. We want what you want to do. We want you to come in powerful ways. No more of the same things that we've been doing. But Lord, come. Lord, come. We need your presence. We need you. We need your glory in our church. Lord, show us your glory." And then one night, as I was praying before the Lord, close to midnight, the Lord says, "Go to the shelter." I said, "God, what did you say?" I said, "Go to the shelter tomorrow." And the shelter was where you guys were worshipping. So the next morning, I told my wife, Rebecca, I said, "I think God wants us to go to the shelter. Will you come with me?" And she said, "Of course, let's go." And when we went to the shelter, there was a gentleman who was blind and who was speaking there that night. And because I remembered Stephen, you know, shelter. So God says, "Go to the shelter." So I went there and he released the word over me that night. And he said, "There's a man here with a blue shirt, long sleeve, with collar, not the one with the t-shirt. And there was nobody else, you know, with a blue shirt." And then I went out and he laid hands and he prayed over me. And he said, "The Lord is going to show you deep things of God. And you will go back and share these insights with your people." Wow, I've been praying for 3 months. God, show us your glory. Speak to me. And then he tells me to go look for Stephen Nicole. Go to where he's having this. And there the Lord spoke through a blind speaker for me. Divine partnership. And I went back, I shared with my church. And we discerned from the Lord what He's saying to us. And now we are praying and pressing in into the things of God. And we are crying out for the glory of God to come. So thank you. Thank you, One Philippians. Thank you, Antioch. Three things that the Lord is showing to us. That we are divinely ordained, divinely connected, and divinely partnered together for ministry. And then the Lord gave me 3 words for Antioch, and I'm going to share these 3 words with you they might mean more to you now or maybe in the future. Just simple words. And the first thing that he said to me was, men of faith, recognize them. Antioch, men of faith, recognize them. There are men of faith, people of faith in the midst that God has brought together. And as I was thinking about the stories that Pastor Stephen had been sharing with me, there are men of faith that have exercised faith to believe and to trust in God. And just a few weeks ago, I was talking to Barbara Cooks, and serves, and I said, oh, so you do this weekly? And I says, yeah, I do this weekly. And she says, so I'm thinking, wow, every week she does that. Then I'm asking, so who is paying for it? It's coming out from your pocket. Yeah, it's coming out from my pocket. There are men and women whom God has placed here. Men and women of faith. And God is saying to you, men and women of faith, you will be the ones who will carry the faith to see what I have planned for Antioch Center for the Nations fulfilled. So recognize the men of faith in the midst of you. Because when you recognize the men of faith in the midst of you and affirm them, you see, faith calls up faith. When I heard Barbara share that, faith rises up in me. And in Romans 1:12, it says, faith encourages faith. So recognize the men of faith, affirm them. And the next thing that faith will do for you is faith will establish your people, and they will empower them to keep their station. You know, when you move on in the ministry, you will require faith. It's just like a jigsaw puzzle. Each one holding their post, each one holding their position, each one exercising faith. So what God is saying to you is, men of faith, recognize them. Faith will ignite faith, and faith will take you to the next level. Antioch Center for the Nations. Next thing, the Kairos moments, remember them. What are your Kairos moments? For us, the Kairos moments are when lightning struck, thunder roared, thing fell to the ground, and God said, intensify your prayer and worship. And those are Kairos moments, and it was fulfilled a few years down the road when Love Singapore said, will you be the prayer tower for the nation? Remember your Kairos moments, because this will be your God stories that you will tell your children and your children's children. And the people who are going to come will not have these experiences of one pemimpin, how you got the place, your Kairos moments, they will not know. So you need to remember, you need to tell the stories, you need to tell the God stories, you need to record them down. And so that they can catch the calling as well. And the third thing is your mission markers. Your mission markers. You are Antioch Center for the Nations. You are not just some organization somewhere wanted to do something for the Lord. You are God ordained. And God is going to use you powerfully. And so what you need to do, you need to register the markers. You know, the Lord gave me a picture when he released this to me. He said, you know, when people are in competition rowing with their backs facing the front, when they row, how do they know they are moving in the right direction and at the right pace and the right focus? Is when they look at the markers on the right and on the right and on the left. And when they look at the markers, they will know how to move forward. So register the markers that God is giving you along the way, the different nations that you go to. And I was so encouraged that you're registering, these are our markers, these are the missionaries, and these are the nations that we're going to now. So along the way, as you keep those markers, you will know how to move forward as the Lord shows you the markers that are on the left and on the right. I'm excited. We have been totally blessed because of you guys coming. And the many times that Pastor Stephen has spoken to our people, many have come down to be prayed for. Many have been stirred, especially for missions. That was once he spoke in 2030. He asked, how many of you believe that God has called you sometime in the future into the mission field to be involved in mission? Between 20 to 30 people came out and prayed for them. And I'm so excited because of the divine connection between One Queen Street and One Queen Street. And I'm looking forward to greater things to come. Shall we pray? I'm just sensing the Lord says that I've brought together men and women of faith. These people will carry my vision. These people will carry the purposes that I've set for Antioch Center for the Nations. And not only will you be relevant to this nation, but you will be relevant to the nations beyond this land. You will be relevant not only to nation, but nations. Not only nations, but you will be relevant to my gospel that will be taken back to Israel, to Jerusalem. And then my son will return. You are part of my design for humanity. You're part of my design to bring about the second coming. You're part of my design. So take note, men and women of faith. Recognize that I have given you faith to move here, to come here, to begin this ministry. And faith will carry you through. Faith will be with you. So I want you to recognize the faith that I have placed in you. And by your exercising of faith, you will call out faith in those around you. You will call out faith that those come to be with you. And you will call out faith from one another. And by that faith, you will stand your station. When tough times come, when challenges come, when you have to exercise that faith to trust in the next check that is going to come, to trust in the next provision that's going to come from God. And you will stay your station no matter what. You will stay your post no matter what. And by that faith, I will fulfill what I've promised at your Center for the Nations, One Birmingham. And now the Lord is asking if you're willing. I just want to invite you, if you're willing. It's not about me. I sense the Lord saying that. Ask them to stand to their feet. And the Lord is asking you, are you willing to go all the way with me? Are you willing to step into the water and trust me? You have to do the stepping into the water. And I will take you on this journey that eyes have not seen and ears have not heard. And you will behold my glory. And the Lord says, if you are willing to say, not I, but Christ. And whatever Christ tells me, I will do. Whatever the Lord shows me, I will say yes. Wherever He leads me, I will go. And He says, stand in covenant with me. Just want to pray for you. So as you covenant with the Lord, just want to come alongside and bless you guys. Because I'm just sensing in the spirit that the Lord has prepared so much for you guys. Oh, Antioch, 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 Antioch. So Father, I stand amazed at you, the special things that you have done and that you're going to do for this group of people that you've called. They're so special, Lord. And Father, I stand on the sidelines and I'm beholding your glory, Lord, even before it happens. And so Father, I release a blessing, Lord, over those brothers and sisters who are standing. And right now, Lord, that because they have stood, they have responded to you, that this response, Lord, will be sealed. This covenant will be sealed. And what you have ordained for Antioch Center for the Nations, one per minpin, will be fulfilled because of the faith, of the willingness to step out of the boat of these, my brothers and sisters. And so, Lord, may you honor them, Lord, as they honor you. May you honor them as they honor you. And may you cause them to be men of faith that will speak and they will act out of faith, Lord. That all those that you have prepared to come and join them, Lord, in this place, Lord, will be called into faith because of their faith. And as they speak of what you have done, as they speak of what you're going to do, as they give thanks to you, as they praise you, Lord, somehow, some way, those who are going to come and join them will find the avalanche of faith that will overflow unto them, Lord, and they will too rise up in faith, Lord, for what you have called one per minpin Antioch Center for the Nations to be. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you,
Lord. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We respond to that prayer. Brought us here to accomplish. We are committed to do exactly what you want us to do. All of our purposes are combined to one purpose, the purpose of God. And he works everything together for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Very often in churches and movements, they develop a mentality of jokingly are referred to as the us four and no more complex, that they just focus, but we are part of a body, a big body of people around the world. And the plans that he has for us, they're not new plans, they're ancient plans. They've been in the making, they've been in the rising for thousands of years. The churches of this nation, and I have similar stories. Lord, show me in spirit people from my home country that are sending agent, that are connected to Ed Poussin, myself. Lord, show me the vision. People way many years ago, entering into a covenant to touch the nation. Lord says, because of their petitions, because of their prayers. And I know that the Lord has brought us, Antioch, to serve this nation, to serve the churches. I'm honored to have one Queen Street here at one pemimpin to do what we're needing to do together. We don't know what we're doing. And I'm glad we don't, because anyone that knows what they're doing is not living by the Spirit. But we will figure it out in the process. The Lord will make it clear. Step by step, you open everything. He'll give us the desires of our heart as a church. He's going to bless us. Many people have many desires. I've asked for him to give you all a nice home, a nice environment. It's never been my priority. I've never really wanted. I knew that God, what a nice environment for your people. It's only one thing I really wanted. You already know my heart's desire above all is God's presence. But after that, it's to send forth laborers into the harvest. And that's exactly what the Lord wants. This nation, Singapore, it's called as a special place. It is Antioch. And many, many thousands of missionaries will go forth from this country and touch this planet for Jesus. Many will come from this place. marching into China, marching into all of Asia and Central Asia, to Kyrgyzstan, into Afghanistan, into Tajikistan, into all that region, Mongolia, all the places we will go and penetrate, and as we go and open doors, we will have people there to help to facilitate the many, many missionaries that will come from many churches. It's an honor, it's a privilege. And Lord, we consecrate ourselves to you. We want to do what you called us to do. We want to serve the churches. Thank you for the pastor coming here tonight and speaking to us. Thank you, Lord. Bless his house. Bless Kum Yan. They have a great heritage. But even greater than their heritage is their future. Great things you're about to do through their house, through their church. We're grateful, Lord. We want to be a part of that. We want to be a part. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We accept these words and we receive it in our hearts. Let one green bean and one Queen Street do your will together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.